I look to the kid who's just a complete nerd about the sport and probably has posters up in their room of their favorite professional runners and is following their favorite professional runners on social media. I just know that that was me.
This is Running for Real, the podcast for runners who know that for every runner's high, there are just as many lows. All those just missed PRs, easy runs that feel hard, injury blues, and more. Each week, we'll talk to running, health, and wellness experts about their highs, lows, and best advice to build our confidence. Running for Real is about being honest, being brave, and most of all, not feeling alone. And now here's our host, whose only ticket was for jumping wakes on a jet ski, Tina Muir.
Hello, my friends. Welcome to episode 31 of the Running for Real podcast. I am really excited that you are here this morning. Maybe it's not morning. Maybe it's afternoon. Maybe it's 11:59 p.m. when you're listening to this. I'm just a morning person, so I always assume everything is in the morning. And my pregnancy means I usually fall asleep by 8 p.m., so I don't make it very far in the evening. So hello to whenever you are listening to this. Thank you so much for tuning in. It truly means the world. So last week we talked to Tom Goom. He's the running physio, had so much good advice for runners on avoiding injuries, recovering from injuries. He truly is a power player in the physio world. And we cover everything about recovery to his cheese addiction. And it was a fun chat. So if you missed that one, make sure you go back and check it out. Today we have another fun one, another honest and real person, you know, very similar to me, but he's much more interesting than I am. I think you're going to like him a lot more, someone you definitely should be following online because he'll give you a laugh, and I definitely enjoy following his social media, and I think you will too. Oh, and by the way, he's run 3:52 in the mile, you know, no big deal. No, absolutely smoking fast, and he is, you know, doing big things, has an exciting future ahead of him, and I think you're going to love him. So without me rambling on too much longer, we will hear from V, we will hear from Body Health, and we'll be right to the interview. Are you ready to meet my running buddy? Because she wants to meet you. I'd like to introduce you, my friends, to V.
Hi, Running for Real listeners. I'm excited to finally meet you. I'm looking forward to telling you more about how I can help you later in the show.
By now, you know me, and I pride myself on being honest. There are a few brands that I talk about more than Body Health, and there's good reason for that. Body Health Perfect Amino helped me recover through my toughest training segments and helped me get to race day fit and healthy. Use coupon code RUNNINGFORREAL for 10% off at bodyhealth.com. Kyle, thank you so much for joining me on the Running for Real podcast. I am really excited to talk to someone who is equally as honest as myself, which doesn't happen too much within the elite world. So welcome to the show.
Yeah, thank you. I guess I'm honest. Yeah, I've always been pretty open about my life. I feel like there's two ways you can go about it. You can be really secretive or you can just let it all out.
Mm-hmm. Well, it just seems like your Twitter feed is just kind of a constant stream of your thoughts as they happen.
Yeah, for better or worse. I maybe should spend a little bit more time editing it. Something's on my mind, I like sharing it.
I think that's a good thing, and I know our listeners are going to appreciate that. So let's kind of dive into the actual running part. You know, I know people are going to be completely wowed by what you can do. I mean, they know a lot of marathoners and long-distance runners, but I don't bring that many mid and kind of what they'll class as short distance, even though I know you're technically a mid-distance runner. So maybe we could talk a bit about your running itself. You know, run 1:47 in the 800, 3:52 in the mile, which you ran that PR this year, which is, you know, amazing. And most of our listeners couldn't even dream of running that time. But as you have broken four so many times now in the mile, does it still kind of feel like it's something that you're proud of and like every time it's exciting, or is it kind of like, did it again?
Yeah. So it's kind of a weird, it's weird in that way because, you know, sometimes I'll have a bad race, but I'll still break 4 minutes in the mile. And I think the running world is, you know, is obviously so excited by a sub 4 minute mile at all times. And it is such a barrier that holds great esteem, but then sometimes you do it and you lose by quite a bit. And so that's always a weird
situation.
But I tallied it up and I've done it 18 times,
wow,
which in my head, it, like the record, I think, is 137 by Steve Scott. I think it's that. And so I feel like,
got a long way to go.
I've got some work to do. not that I'm going to measure myself against Steve Scott.
Well, that's still amazing 18. And actually I did consider that when I was researching this. I was like, should I go through, try and add them all up? Like, but then I was like, I don't know, I'll miss some. And then I'll say, oh, you've run 15. And you're like, no, actually it's 17 or 18. Yeah. So I'm glad I didn't, but thank you for telling us. That is really cool to hear.
I had some time to research it.
Was that before this interview or just general?
I did it earlier in the summer. I started counting them up. And now the last couple that I've done, I've added to the document.
Uh-huh. That's cool. Yeah. And do you have a favorite one? Was it the first time or was it any
the first
other
time? Yeah, the first time you do it is it's in some ways just a weight is lifted off your shoulders, mm-hmm. because, you know, you think you can do it. You've gotten close before. The first time you really need things to basically go perfect because you're probably not in 352 mile shape the first time you do it. And so, the first time I was, I think 19 years old and it was indoors at the Armory, which was my home track in college with lots of friends and family there. And so that was probably the most special.
Oh, that is cool. And Armory is always a great place to build up the excitement and kind of have that buzz, especially like you said, if that's your home track, that's an awesome place to do it. Okay. And then, so you've been with Hoka One One for 4 years now. And firstly, I was curious with that, just as a lot of elite runners seem to kind of bounce around brands or, you know, I'm sure some of the big, you know, the big time, the, I don't know about Nike, but some of the other ones may have approached you over the years. But why Hoka? Why are you loyal to Hoka? What is it about them that you feel are special?
Yeah, so I came out of college in 2013 and, you know, I'd had a rough year. I did well in 2012, but was then dealing with injuries. And so I was unsponsored and had to work at a shoe store in New Jersey just to, you know, make ends meet, mm-hmm. in combination with the support of the New Jersey New York Track Club. And then that summer of 2014, I started stringing together some races. I'd been hurt in the spring, but then took a chance on myself and going to Europe. I didn't make the final of USA's that year. I missed it by much less than a second. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Europe was going to be an expensive trip for me, but I decided to throw it on the credit card and just take the risk. And I went over there and I PR'd, ran 3:56 in the mile, which was the first time I'd done a PR in the mile in 4.5 years leading into that. And then a week later I ran 3:54. And when I got back from Europe, I thought there would be endless shoe companies. Mm-hmm. You know, you always value yourself so high. I thought I'd have a mailbox full of letters and, you know, unfortunately, that wasn't the case. I think in the sport, a lot of people value, you know, it's not so much as what you do one time, but what you can do again and again and again. And so it took a couple more races for me to really prove myself besides just running 1:354. And that's when Hoka had just come onto the scene. They started by signing Mike Rutt and Leo Manzano. And I think Nicole Tully was one of the first. And then they came to me and their enthusiasm at the time and always is just really what stood out for me. Mm-hmm. You obviously hear so much about athletes and contracts and you hear a lot of bad things all the time. You hear athletes, you know, getting to disagreements with shoe companies or getting cut or getting let go after some of their best performances. But I think Hoka, their interest when they were signing me was their first priority was like, all right, well, we need to get you to quit this other job. And so you can do this full time.
Wow. That's cool.
And I don't think that's something that you hear from a lot of companies.
No, not at all.
I think they saw some potential and they knew that, you know, if I could stop working 25 hours a week, that maybe I would be able to get even quicker. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, for me, that really stood out. And then on top of everything, I guess this is starting to wear off a little because Hoka has grown so much. But in the beginning, I thought it was really exciting to be part of a new company.
Yeah, yeah.
It was something that people weren't aware of. I mean, you could run for Nike, but people already know Nike. But, you know, now people know Hoka. But in 2014, when I told someone I was sponsored by Hoka, there was a real opportunity to actually educate and sell some shoes right on the spot.
Awesome.
It's always been a really fun thing to be a part of.
And it seems like there's still kind of that brand. I had Devin Yanko on a few weeks ago, and she was kind of talking about the same thing within the, you know, the other end of the spectrum on the ultra world. But seems like they're really, you know, continuing that kind of same personality within the brand.
Yeah. You know, if you see someone wearing Hokas on the street and you say nice Hokas, they'll tell you a story about why they're in Hokas and how much they love them. And I think that's pretty unique to the brand. And also, as you're saying, you know, Hoka got its start in ultra running and on the trails, and they've really maintained their dedication there while expanding into the track world. So I think it's rare that a company would do both. Oftentimes you'd have a trail shoe company or, you know, a shoe company that really just focuses on the roads or on the track. So to have a hybrid is, you know, it's fun.
Yeah. Okay. And then as you are someone who is honest, when they first approached you with the shoe themselves, were you a little bit like, what are these? Or did you kind of get excited thinking, you know what, they're out here, they must have, you know, done their research or something?
I remember when Mike Rutt, my teammate, first signed with Hoka, and he showed up at practice wearing them. And I was like, what are you wearing? Like, you look like what you've grown a couple inches. And when Hoka had reached out to me and I met with them for the first time at a race in Eugene, you know, they said, you know, we're really interested in you. And I had to be honest. And I said, I am super glad to hear that, but there is no way I can endorse a product if I don't believe in them. And so I need to try them. And as I laced them on for the first time, I was skeptical, and it just took a minute jog, a couple strides. Really? I said, I could definitely run in these.
Mm-hmm. And it probably helped as they started to develop like spike. They do make spikes now, right? They're definitely flats they were initially kind of bringing out, which probably helped with the situation.
Yeah. That's part of the exciting part about running for Hoka, especially in the beginning, was that I got to have input through this whole process.
Yeah.
That first year, you know, they didn't have flats, and eventually they came out with prototypes, and I got an opportunity to try those on and give some feedback. And then the first spikes that they ever made, I mean, the first prototypes, you know, we had a lot of feedback to give. And now through a couple different versions of spikes, they keep getting better and better. And now I think the Evo that they have, and I've worn and PR'd in many times. So I think, maybe I said something along the way that had a positive impact in the development.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And then, so then what would you say to someone listening who may have been in that same boat to you, thinking, you know, what are these shoes? These are, you know, I'm supposed to be going minimalist. What am I doing? Like, what would you like to say to people?
I think the biggest thing is obviously trying them. You can look at a shoe, but you don't know what a shoe is going to feel like. Even if you just try it on, you know, without going for a run, I think you gotta go for an actual run in them and experience them for yourself. Mm-hmm. And again, my background is in run specialty. I worked in run specialty for a long time, and not every shoe is going to be perfect for everyone. I love the Clifton 4s. Like, they just feel incredible on my feet and my stride, but you know, that's not necessarily going to be the case for everyone. Maybe it's a different version Hoka, maybe it's not Hoka, but I would just encourage everyone to at least give them a try, because it's worked for myself and so many other athletes. Mm-hmm.
So you are an ambassador of kind of the comfort is your guide for when it comes to picking shoes.
Yeah, I think so. Do they look nice?
Always important.
Yeah, your favorite color.
So one of the other things Hoka does is, you know, works with you on the Long Island Mile, which is, you know, you are the meet director. It was just a few months ago when this goes live. So firstly, before we kind of go into that itself, you know, you ended up as the meet director, unless that was a joke that I saw on a video. No, you are? Okay.
I'm definitely a meet director.
What made you want to be a meet director of, you know, a race? Was that something you picked up yourself?
Yeah. So I worked at Sayville Running Company when I was in college, and myself and Brendan Barrett, who's the owner of the store, we basically just would sit around the shop brainstorming. At the time, he was a new shoe shop, and we had a lot of downtime, and we'd just be talking about the different things that we could be doing to help the local running community, in addition to just putting on road races and getting everyone in some proper footwear. And one of the ideas was a festival of miles, a night in which the racers start slow and get faster as the night goes on. And as the opportunity came out, once I turned professional, to maybe have access to the funds and the athletes and just the know about, like, just to understand how to even put on an elite track meet. So we pitched it to Hoka. We created a huge business plan, worked on it for a long time, and we went down to the running event in Austin and we sat down at a meeting with them. And before we could even like turn the page, they just like looked at each other and like, all right, let's do it. And it was like, we have 9-10 more pages of like information that we've gathered. Like, can we finish presenting? And so they loved the idea, and they immediately threw some funding behind it, and it went off well. And, you know, we ran fast, and then the second year it turned around and I said, all right, like, I want to do it again. Like, can I have more and make this thing even bigger? And I feel like every year this race gets bigger and bigger, and it mm-hmm. becomes, I think it's a great thing, obviously, for Long Island, and I think for Hoka as well.
Yeah. And well, and just, you know, the whole running world in general, it's become one of the biggest mile races of the year. And it's just been really cool to kind of see how much it's grown over the past few years. So definitely something to be proud of. And, you know, this year was particularly special for you. You renamed the race. So maybe either you can say about why you decided to rename it, or I don't mind saying it if you would rather that. So
yeah, it's okay. So I guess I should start with that first year when we were putting on the race. The hardest part is getting a field together and convincing athletes to come.
Yeah.
And, you know, I really had to call in some favors and ask some friends to please like support my race and help me build something. And one of those first people that I called was David Torrence. And, you know, it took a little bit of convincing, but he came and he won the race in 3:53 and immediately put us on the map. And for that, I'm so grateful. And he came back again the second year and won the race again. And he's a Hoka athlete and we've been racing for years. And so I had a really, really good chance to spend a lot of time with David through the years. And unfortunately, he passed away just recently. And, you know, it was right before the Long Island Mile this year. And he was supposed to come back again, stay at my house for the third year and, you know, defend that title, go for the three-peat. And obviously, he didn't get the opportunity to do that. And so it was, you know, I don't know if there is any way that you could ever truly heal from that, especially for his closest friends and his family. Mm-hmm. But I think it was really good for the running community. And I know at least for myself in the wake of tragedy to be able to come together and celebrate his life.
Yeah. And it was really cool. And you had everyone, you know, write DT on the jersey, you know, tell us about that. What was the, you know, why write it down on the jerseys?
Yeah. So a fun thing that we would always do at the mile is leave the bib numbers blank and allow athletes to kind of write their own thing. So the first couple of years I just wrote meet director on my bib. And David wore DT, his initials and nickname. And so this year, you know, a lot of the athletes paid tribute to David in that space. But, you know, I think the coolest thing that we did was we left hip number one open for David, and his family came to the race and were there to watch and support. And, you know, we told stories and laughed and just, you know, try to keep his memory alive as best as possible. But right before the race, it was a complete downpour, but we still announced David and his incredible accomplishments. And it was a tough moment. It was, mm-hmm. you know, a lot of us were speaking after the race and we were talking about the fact that it was hard to emotionally come back into race mode after, you know, tearing up there and listening to his name called.
Mm-hmm. No, but, you know, it was a great event, and everything I read about it just said that it was just such a special evening in so many ways, and just really cool that, you know, you were able to hold it in his honor and kind of, you know, I'm sure he's, you know, looking down and kind of appreciating that. So, you know, really cool that you were able to do that. And what did, like, his passing teach you about your dreams? I know David was always like a go-getter when it came to races. So has that changed anything about you and your racing?
I think the thing that it's maybe changed, or not changed, or the thing that has made me realize the most is the people that we're racing against constantly, and we're traveling the world racing with, and, you know, racing against, you know, this elite running community, especially, you know, for me, the milers, it's so much more than just coworkers or competitors. Like, you know, over the years, these are people that we've been racing for, some of us, since high school. We really do have a deeper friendship mm-hmm. than what's maybe seen on the track. And I know that between the Long Island Mile and Fifth Avenue, and then the third race, the meet that I did after in Alaska, that camaraderie was really high. And I think people were appreciating each other a little bit more than maybe we would have taken for granted in the past.
Absolutely.
Just taking a moment to, you know, really express to each other, you know, our gratitude for friendship.
Would you say that's changed, like, before the race as well? Or you just mean, like, afterwards? Because I know, you know, afterwards people kind of celebrate each other, but you mean before as well?
I think before, in the you know, days leading in.
Great. Mm-hmm.
It was just, it really was like a palpable energy of togetherness and, I don't know, mutual respect and love. And mm-hmm. I just think it brought us closer together.
No, that's really cool. And especially for you guys, like, being, you know, milers who can race more often, you know, myself personally at the marathons, you know, I would go to a marathon and I'd see maybe 4 or 5 people, and then it'd be 3 or 4 months and I see a different group of 4 or 5 people. Whereas, you know, for you guys, it's kind of the same group turning up week after week. So I could definitely see that being, you know, it should be in theory that everyone is kind of close and, you know, good friends, but I could definitely see how that wouldn't have been the case, but cool that it's taken that step now. So appreciative to him for that as well. And I hope it's kind of the same within the distance community, even though it's going to be a while before I get back up there now. But
yeah, not quite as many opportunities.
No, definitely not. Okay, I have to ask about Gags. Much a legend within the running world. A lot of our longer distance people might not have known of him, but as I, you know, lived in Philly for 2 years, worked under Dan Island, who is now the Columbia coach.
Yeah.
And, you know, have heard so many things about Gags. You know, for those who do know him, or maybe just those who are interested, maybe tell us a bit about what he's like, because he is just so, so well known within the running community.
Yeah. So Gags, or I guess Coach Frank Gagliano, he's everything you would expect in, like, an 80-year-old Italian man from the Bronx. He's really, like, crushing all potential stereotypes there. Shows up to practice in his Yankees hat. And I mean, the thing about Gags is he's definitely, depending on who you talk to and when they were maybe coached by him or most familiar, you might get slightly different stories. Cause I think he's a former football player, and he never ran track. He just got into coaching it. So the fact that someone who had never, you know, raced anything in his life, or, you know, the fact that he has found a way to the top of the track and field world is an admirable testament to anything being possible. And so when he was younger, he still has this for sure, but I mean, he was intense and loud, and he could be mean, and he would just be screaming the whole practice. And I think he's gradually softened as he's gotten older. And now I'm entering my 5th year with the New Jersey New York Track Club. And he is definitely, he's got a soft spot that shows quite often. And for an 8-year-old man, he can bring a lot of intensity day in and day out to practice. But you'll see both sides over the course of a season. And yeah, I mean, he doesn't seem 80, would also be a huge part of running mm-hmm. for him.
Mm-hmm.
He's still there.
No, I definitely can attest to that as well. So what was it about him that drew you to, was it New York, New Jersey itself? Was it him? Was it something else initially when you came out of college or maybe just being in the area?
Yeah, I think I'm from Long Island and went to school in Manhattan and my family is here and all my friends. And so staying in New York is obviously a huge draw, but I think you could probably attest this as well. A coach believing in you goes such a long way. I mean, everyone can write a workout or can write a plan, but having a coach who can convince you that you can be better than you are, mm-hmm. I think that's maybe the greatest skill and motivation that a coach can really provide. And so, you know, coming out of college, as I was saying earlier, unsponsored and, you know, having had a year of struggles, for Gags to show so much, you know, so much enthusiasm about coaching me and really, really convinced me that he could take me to another level. I mean, that spoke volumes.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I can completely see that. And, you know, it's so cool that you were able to find that so close to where you were, because I think a lot of people, especially elites, have to move around to find that person. So amazing that you were able to find him, you know, right there with you and stay close to family and everything. So, you know, that's awesome. And, you know, New York, New Jersey has grown a lot since you've been there. How has that been, seeing it become this hub for you know, distance runners, for mid-distance runners, for, shorter distance runners? What has that been like?
Yeah. So, I mean, the evolution of the New Jersey New York Track Club it's been really fun. When the club first started, it was really like, it was hardly a track club. It was just Gags coaching a couple athletes, like Aaron Donahue and Julie Cully, two local athletes in New Jersey. When Gags moved back to New York, they needed a coach and asked Gags, and, you know, they met at a high school track a couple days a week. And super informal. And now we are the Hoka New Jersey New York Track Club. Our athletes are all full-time professionals. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the goal is now not to make USAs, it's to qualify for world and Olympic teams. And I think the way it's become possible is Gags has an eye for talent. I think sometimes, you know, he'll pick someone out of a lineup and, you know, maybe their PRs aren't the fastest, but he sees something, and mm-hmm. whether it's in their attitude or their stride or something about, maybe it's just his confidence and his ability to coach people, but he definitely likes handpicking people more than just who has the fastest times.
Yeah, that's so cool. And then tell us about training itself. What is training for the mile involved? I'm sure most of our listeners have absolutely no idea. So maybe you could give us an average week or something similar to that.
Yeah. So we probably run, it depends on who you are on the team, probably 70 to 90 miles a week, depending on who you are. At my highest, I'll be in the low 90s, but we work out a lot. And that's probably a major difference between what we do and what a marathoner would do. Mm-hmm. The Gags thing that you'll hear him say constantly is that you put strength and speed in a bowl, mix it up, and you get a champion. And so for us, it's a combination, you know, of hitting all the different paces in a marathon. You know, if you're trying to run 5:20 pace, you will run 5:20 pace constantly. And we will run everything from quarters and 50 to quarters and 75. And so Monday we do long intervals. It's like 800 to mile repeats with a minute or two rest. And maybe that's like 8 to 10K worth of work. On Tuesday, we would do an easy run. On Wednesday morning, we'll do a tempo run, generally 4 to 6 miles, and then come back in the evening and do either hills or some short sprints. Thursday, we would do another easy run. And then Friday, we would do something really specific. It would be, you know, 400 repeats at mile pace or 1,000 with 6 minutes recovery and then an 800 with 5 minutes recovery and then a 600 and then a 300. And like, that's the entire workout. So something,
this one's a killer.
Yeah. Really short and specific, and you're spiked up the whole time. And it's, feels like it's close to a time trial. And then Saturday we would do a long run, which, you know, I think, a lot of people are always surprised at how long we do our long runs. 'Cause while only racing a mile, there's still a need for a lot of aerobic abilities. And so we do 2 hour long runs a lot of the time. I fit 20 miles in there before. And then Sunday is just like as easy as you can possibly go, just recover and you do it all over again and multiply that for 20 weeks. And you've hopefully got a good season on your hands.
So with that, you know, I understand this having done mile training in the past, but for someone listening, they're either thinking, so we're going to address both sides of this. They're either thinking, oh my God, how is that even possible? I couldn't do that if I tried. So what would you like to say to those people who are thinking, you know, kind of seeing it as if they tried to do that tomorrow, they wouldn't be able to, which is probably true. What would you say that?
Well, I think a big part of it is that we didn't try and jump into it in one day.
Yep.
Obviously, since, you know, high school, I've been training pretty seriously. And then on top of that, even coming out of college, there was another big jump to professional level training. And that first year that I was with the club, my mileage was short, was a bit less, and the workouts less intense. And every year you build on it. Mm-hmm. So I don't think jumping in it tomorrow would be a good idea for any of the listeners, but if they've got like 5 years to spare.
Yeah. And so the other side of that, which you kind of answered a little bit, is someone who thinks, okay, well, I want to run the mile, so maybe I'll do, you know, what he's saying, but maybe tone down a little bit to my speed. Do you think, you know, that even if you do slow down the paces, it is just a kind of gradual increase that you've added those workouts in? Like maybe in college, you only did, you did two workouts a week plus, you know, maybe a higher intensity long run or something like that. How would that, how does it progress just for someone who is interested in trying?
It would definitely require some getting used to if you're, you know, adding in, because I like to say we do 3.5 workouts a week. And so if you're used to a standard 2, then it might not be the first week. Like you can do it one time for sure. And you can probably do it 2-3 weeks in a row, but eventually the accumulation will start to wear on you. Mm-hmm. And that's why I like to think we're doing a bunch of medium workouts versus a bunch of high intensity, or, you know, like no one workout is going to be the end all be all, especially in our system. It's just about general fitness improvement and stringing as many days and positive workouts together. It's not about an A+. It's about passing each workout.
So true. So true. And anyone listening, you can apply that to any distance you're training for, really. You don't want to be trying to hit one workout. It's about the accumulation. Just like Kyle is saying. And then you mentioned earlier that, you know, Gags talks about speed and strength in a bowl. And, you know, you said about your long runs. So maybe explain that to people. Why, you know, if they're thinking, well, you're racing a mile, why are you running 2 hours, or why are you doing these, you know, 70 to 90 miles a week when you're only running a mile?
Yeah. Well, I mean, the thing is the first 3/4 of a mile, I'm not going to say it's easy, but that's not the hard part. I think it's about getting through to the point in the race where you can kick as easily as possible. And to do that, you have to be really strong and be able to do it with your eyes closed, more or less. And then in a mile, it's just about who has the most, that final 200, more or less. Mm-hmm. And so it is so much mileage for such a short distance, but it's so different than a marathon where you have, the challenge isn't in the distance. You know, in a marathon, you're building your runs and your long runs and your tempos and working your ability to be able to sustain just, I mean, not even the pace at that distance or time, but just to be able to run that long straight forward. And for a mile, it's just about efficiency. Mm-hmm. Getting to the point with 200 meters to go as efficiently as possible. And to do that, you need to be really strong.
Yep. So true. And I will say to anyone listening, even if you aren't going to be running a, you know, 352 mile anytime soon, this still applies to you. Like we, you know, in my training plans, the 5K, 10K in particular, I don't have a shorter than that. But I have people doing, you know, up to 15-mile long runs because it is important no matter what distance you're racing. So even if you are going to do a mile and you're not going to, you know, maybe run it as fast as Kyle, you still need to kind of keep that same concept. So listen to what he's saying here because it is, you know, very important. All right. So I wanted to talk to you. I mentioned this to you before we started chatting a bit, but you're kind of known for your sense of humor, being real. As we said, I can't remember if we said this on air or off air, your Twitter feed is kind of like a stream of consciousness as your thoughts come out. So, you know, I mentioned this to you at the beginning that, you know, I pride myself on being real. You do it in a bit more of a fun way. I feel like pretty boring compared to you, but why do you feel that you're okay to kind of share things with people when most elites keep things very like close to their chest and don't want to show weakness and don't want to show that, you know, maybe they're not all serious all the time?
I think it stems from the fact of where I got my start in running. And a lot of my running career, I had to find, especially when I was younger, I had to find inspiration in others. I didn't go to a powerhouse high school with, you know, that was making NXN, and I was doing a lot of distance runs completely by myself. And therefore, I kind of had to turn to the internet to learn about distance running. I had to learn about the best runners and see what they were doing. And I would watch their races and I would see their results. And I don't know, do you remember Diestat?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And like the message boards. So I was largely on the Diestat message boards and the Let's Run message boards and just reading. And this is like 15, 16 year old me, and just having to become educated. And therefore, like I really see myself as a fan in many ways who has been fortunate enough to come up and be able to compete in the races that I was once watching. And therefore, I always just want to open up and give back as much as possible. Not that I'm doing anything super honorable, but just give back in the sense that maybe by being a real person and coming off as a normal human rather than a robot, that maybe there's another 15-year-old kid who is running by himself every single day, but seeing me make it on the pro stage can convince them that it's possible.
Yeah. And I bet you have had some people over the years now that have come up to you and kind of said that you inspire them.
Okay. Yeah.
How does that
feel? Anytime anyone says that, it feels really good. And I always will then see myself in them. Like, especially when I visit cross country camps, which I really love to do. And I try and do a few every summer because I always think cross country camp was such a big deal for me because it was one of the first times that I really got a chance to interact with other runners outside of the internet. And I look to the kid who's, you know, just a complete nerd about the sport and just loves it and just probably has posters up in their room of their favorite professional runners and is following their favorite professional runners on social media. And I just know that that was me. And that's the market that I want to help.
Yeah. And I think you definitely are. And, you know, I know from experience how much people appreciate someone who is being honest and saying, you know, the truth about things. And, you know, do you have any theories? I mean, I'm always trying to figure this out because I get asked this question all the time on why other elite runners do struggle to kind of show that kind of real side or the fun side of running.
Yeah, I think there's probably everyone has their own reason, but you know, there is certain people who really like to keep their training private or how things are going to themselves, because when they get on the start line, maybe they believe it would give someone else an advantage if they were aware of how things have been going for them. Or, you know, some people, it's just not even necessarily them as runners, but just as people, not everyone is super open. Personally though, like I think something that the sport really benefits from is having personalities. You know, the runners that I rooted for were the ones who were sharing.
So and who was that? Just so we can kind of be, as I'm curious.
Yeah. One of my favorite runners was Craig Mottram.
Okay. Yep.
Just because in his interviews, he was so honest and open about how things were going. And when I got a chance to meet him when I was in high school, like he was just a normal, real person. And so that made me want to root for him.
That's so funny, because I met him in high school as well, and I felt exactly the same way. Anyway,
keep going. So, you know, I think that you see it in other sports. The athletes really just by no means am I saying that this is what I'm doing, but maybe what I'm aspiring to. But I think certain athletes can transcend beyond the sport.
Absolutely.
We know Tom Brady, the person. And because of that, people will either root for him or against him because they know who Tom Brady is. They obviously, it's helpful that he's a great player, but you know, I think there's aspects of his personality that make people a fan or not. I think that track field would really benefit as we are, you know, constantly clawing for ratings or people to watch to tell the stories of athletes, or for athletes to tell their own stories. And so that's partially my motivation, is I think even if I'm tweeting about nonsensical things that have nothing to do with running, or if I'm sharing pictures of me on vacation or of me and my family, hopefully it will allow me to connect, or for a fan to feel connected with me. And so that way, when I'm on the track, they're rooting for something more than just Kyle Merber, the runner, but maybe they're rooting for Kyle Merber, the person.
Oh, I love that. Everything you just said, I just agree with 100%. I love that so much. And that actually leads in perfectly to the final thing I was going to ask you about, which was, you know, we're struggling with numbers and attendance, and, you know, sponsors are getting a bit more cutthroat with less money around. And, you know, there's this temptation to go for like the lifestyle stuff. So, you know, I was going to ask you what your opinion is, what we can do to save track and field. But do you think that is, you know, a primary thing here, is getting people to kind of open up so people actually care about the individuals?
Yeah. I've said this before, where like, if you go to a golf course and you ask any golfer, name their top five favorite golfers, they could name 10. But if you go to a local high school track and you ask anyone on the track for five of their favorite runners, they'll just tell you like Usain Bolt and Jesse Owens, or, you know, like they don't know. And so there's clearly a disconnect, because high school track has the greatest numbers in the US in terms of participation, yet it doesn't convert at all to, you know, the actual professional side of things. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a way to bridge that gap somehow, some way. And I think the presentation is obviously huge. There's certain times when you'll be watching on TV and they're building a storyline, and I'm like, good, this is the story. Like, you need to build it. And then there's other times where you don't know anything going into the race. And so it's like, well, what do I care? Like, mm-hmm. what is on the line here? And so you need to promote a plot. I also would say that I think individual races or premier events are way more important than entire track meets. I think when you show up to a track meet and there's 20 events going on, it could be a little bit too much stimulation fans. You know, there's obviously, like, I think when the shot put is happening, it deserves full appreciation and attention, and not to just be happening on the infield while the 1500 is going on. And so I think specialty focused events is really good. So that's why the stuff like the Long Island Mile or the Sir Walter Mile or any of these races that are just focused on one event is really good. Like, I think there should be the equivalent for everything. I think there should be like a meet where it's just hundreds, and that everything builds into like where the 100 is the race at the very end. Then it creates suspense, and you have time to build each individual that's in the race rather than trying to understand everything that's happening. It's like going to the Cheesecake Factory and seeing like the book that they give you as a and then I'm just like, well, I don't even know what I want now because there's too many options.
Very true.
I almost like retract into myself and like, we'll just get a cheeseburger.
That's so true. Such a good thing to think about. Like, the way you've looked at that, I love that. And actually, kind of related, in England, when we show the, you know, the World Championships or the Olympics or something, I don't know if you've ever been over there, or I don't know if it's the same in the rest of Europe, but when they're showing an event, they show each person, they put the screen on the person, they say what their PRs are, they say what they've been doing this year, they might say, you know, they've had a rough year with blah, blah, blah. But they give you probably 30 seconds about that, or maybe 15 seconds about that person. But yeah. Then I notice when I watch over here on NBC, it's literally focusing on the Americans. And then maybe if it's a final, you might get to flick across to a few other people like Usain Bolt or Mo Farah or someone like that. But for the most part, you don't really get to know anyone else or what's going on and kind of, like you said, the story behind it. So there's so many ways that we could kind of develop this, and it really wouldn't involve too much other than just, like you said, focusing on the events and what's going on behind it rather than it just being a physical race. So
yeah. And you know, that's why, like, in an international competition, it's really easy because there's something on the line in every single race. You know, no matter who wins the 400 at the Olympics, someone's about to become an Olympic champion. But at other track meets, there's just no one cares because there's nothing really big on the line. Yeah. And that's why when there's when one or two races is the entire focus of a meet, suddenly there becomes way more in line because they are the focus. And that's why everyone is there.
I love that idea. Yeah.
Yeah. And then, but then again, like, I don't know if we can completely rely on the TV crew to do it for us. And that's why I think as athletes, it's important for us to promote ourselves.
Yeah. Great. Well, I know we have a number of elites that listen to this, so start banding together and see what we can do here. So thank you for your suggestions there. And if anyone else listening has any ideas, I'd love to hear them. So, you know, you can send me an email or reach out somehow, and, you know, it'd be really cool. Maybe tweet at Kyle. He'll respond and see what we can get together. So before we go on to the sponsor messages, I just want to ask you one question, which is, if you were to give an Oscar speech, who would you thank?
Oh, did I accomplish something?
Yes.
In the running world?
You can accomplish an acting Oscar if you like.
Well, I would have to give a very special shout out to my family and fiance, who obviously the biggest support system possible.
Uh-huh. Who will be your wife by the time this goes live.
Yeah, will be my wife in just over a week. And so I think surrounding yourself with people who are supportive to you day in and day out and just make you feel comfortable. My family knows that I don't really like talking about running with them, but they show their support in other ways. They don't want to know how every single workout does because I don't want to tell them, but just by showing up to the races and, you know, being there at the finish line, I think the actions speak for themselves. And then you'd have to give props to all the coaches that you've ever had from day one.
Yeah.
They're the ones who molded you. And then finally, I'm going to give a nice shout out to the internet.
Way to get everyone there in the world. You've thanked everyone.
But as I was saying earlier, though, like, the internet really did play a huge role in me coming into the running world and educating me. And so the running internet.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And thanks to the internet as well. I guess we can all give the internet a thanks.
Yeah.
Random thing. Have you seen, I don't know if you watch this or not, but there's a South Park episode about where the internet breaks. And it's like, it's really funny. And when you were talking about that, it just made me think of that. Someone listening will know what I'm talking about.
Hopefully that never happens.
Yeah. Okay. We're just going to take a moment to thank our sponsors and we'll be right back with the Running for Real 4. I teased you with it a little bit earlier in the show, and it is now time for me to introduce you to V, my running buddy these past few months, and she gets to know me a little bit more every day. I know she can't wait to get to know you too, so welcome, V.
Hi, Running for Real listeners. It's really great to be with you. I've had a really busy summer, which has been exhausting, but every day I'm getting stronger, faster, and better.
For those of you who don't know V, she is the world's first AI personal trainer. And she lives in a beautifully designed Harman Kardon, aka a really good brand, Bluetooth earphones with aerospace-grade biosensors, which measure your heart rate, speed, cadence, and more. Basically, she's far more accurate than any of the other wearables out there right now. V, what else can you do?
Well, I'm just getting started, but I can help runners find and stay in their ideal heart rate zone so their workouts are more effective. I can also improve cadence, keep track of records, suggest run mantras, and let runners know when their pace is fluctuating so they can correct it on the spot. But ultimately, I just want to boost runners with motivation so they can have a more enjoyable and fun workout.
Avoiding injuries, motivation, and enjoying running more, I don't know what else we can ask for. Thank you, V. I'm so glad you were able to introduce yourself to my crew. And for the listeners, you can find out more at getv.com/runningsurreal, where you can enter to win your own V.
Thank you, Tina. See you on our next run.
It's racing season. All those moments of hard work, dedication, early nights are ready to show their worth as race day approaches. For me, though, this was always the time I felt the worst. All those accumulated miles are in your legs, and race day looms, your mind starts to spin into overdrive, wondering, why don't I feel good? And you just don't seem to be recovering. Now, it's hard to overcome, but one trick I had up my sleeve was to take 10 Body Health Perfect Amino. And that allowed me to recover just that little bit faster, enough to convince my mind that I was going to be okay. And after the races, when that soreness leaves you pretty much unable to walk, it was Perfect Amino that I relied on to nurse me back to normal. Well, at least so I could walk normally rather than like I was 150 years old. Now, there was one thing I didn't like about those Perfect Amino tablets, and that was having to swallow 10 in one go. That's no easy feat. But the stubborn runner in me had to do it that way. But now Body Health has created Perfect Amino XP packets containing those 8 amino acids essential to recovery. And as it's a powder, you can add it to any drink, especially for those moments you can't get a recovery meal in right away. And let's face it, that happens often. Go to bodyhealth.com and remember to use coupon code RUNNINGFORREAL for 10% off. All right, Kyle, four more questions for you, starting with either a unique nutrition tip or something you use that, you eat that people wouldn't know about.
I think that's important. I have a Nutribullet and I try and smoothie once a day.
That's a good plan. What's and your favorite smoothie recipe for anyone listening?
So, I mean, a banana is at the base always. You got some spinach and kale in there, an assortment of berries, and then an almond or coconut milk and some oats. And then the secret ingredient that you can put in any smoothie and it'll make it taste amazing is peanut butter.
Yes, I do that too. So good. Yeah. Okay, what about a running for real moment, a moment that only runners will understand?
Ooh, a moment only runners will understand. When you're coming up on someone on the trail and you're like supposed to turn around as soon as you pass them.
Yeah, that's the worst.
And it's just like, do I pass them and then immediately flip? Or do I just like turn around 20 seconds early?
Yeah, that's always awkward. And I bet that's something no one has ever brought up before, but I'm sure every runner has experienced that at some point.
Yeah.
What about a high moment to you and why it meant so much?
A high moment. I think a high moment for me would be when I competed at the World Relays in the Bahamas in 2015. Mm. We won and set the world record in the distance medley relay. And for me, just like, you know, the dream is always to represent the US as much as possible and to do it as best as you can. And hearing like the national anthem play while on top of the podium was motivating to keep doing cool. This.
Definitely cool. And well done for that. And finally, what do you tell yourself when you're standing on the start line?
For me, it's just like really forcing myself to smile and relax, because, you know, it's so easy to get caught up in that first, you know, turn or that first couple hundred meters, but it's a long race. And, you know, the more energy you can conserve in the beginning, the more you'll have at the end.
So true. And so such good advice there. Finally, I ask my guests to send a photo that I can put on the show notes of them standing in a power pose. So that's something you would do on the start line, you know, to build your confidence. Maybe the camera's rolling by and you're like, stand maybe hands on hips or whatever. Will you send us a photo of you in your power pose? I'm sure you must have one from a race at some point.
Yeah, I definitely will. But my power pose is probably just like the overhead, very unassuming wave.
Okay.
To the crowd.
But, nothing wrong with that.
I can try and find a more powerful position.
Sure. Well, I guess most of our listeners don't have a crowd to wave to. So you've got that added benefit that you can enjoy waving to the crowd when they call you.
They should just be waving anyway.
Well, technically, there's always people at the start line, so you could be waving to them. So they're your crowd. Well, Kyle, thank you so much for being honest, for being real, and, you know, just sharing so much with us. This was great to chat, and I know our listeners are really going to love it. So how can they find more about you? I mean, we've mentioned your Twitter. Maybe tell us where they can find you, and I'll put links in the show notes.
Yeah, my Twitter handle is TheRealMerb, and my Instagram is Kyle Merber. Yeah, it's probably easiest to find me on there.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, I recommend you go follow him on Twitter. You will be laughing pretty quick, and just he will just brighten your day with his tweets. Or if you want to follow him on Instagram, if you don't use either of those, I'm not really sure what to suggest. You could go to his website, but I don't know how much he updates that. But anyway, you can find everything we talked about, links and everything, on the show notes at tinamuir.com/episode31. I want to take this time to thank you for listening today. If you do have any suggestions on what Kyle and I were talking about with, you know, how we can improve our running world, what difference we can make to keep bringing the attention back to running and make it kind of exciting again, I'd love to hear from you. So you can either tweet at me, at Tina Muir, or Kyle, which is at The Real Merb. And you can tell us what you're thinking, any other ideas you have. Next week, we are going to be talking to Renee McGregor about her new book on orthorexia and our obsession with clean eating that we're kind of edging into, which is getting a bit scary. And she is going to surprise you with what she said, much in the way that Nancy Clark did. Renee works with the British Olympic runners, and you're going to want to hear what she has to say. She's not going to tell you that you need to eat clean. She's not going to tell you that you need to, you know, stick to a strict diet or anything. I think she's really real and fun and just a great woman. So I think you're really going to enjoy that one next week. So until then, have a great week. Hope you enjoyed the episode.
Thanks for listening to the Running for Real podcast. Be sure to check out tinamuir.com for show notes and even more helpful running information.